Hello, I'm Jonathan Moyes, Head of Investment Research at Wealth Club, and today I'm with Shane Gallwey of Guinness Ventures to talk about the Guinness EIS Fund. Hello Shane, welcome back to the studio.
Thank you, John.
So for those who aren't familiar, could you give us some background to Guinness Ventures and your own experience?
We've been investors at Guinness Asset Management for 20 years, and our flagship funds trade under Guinness Global Investors, mm-hmm. and they include the Sustainable Energy Fund, the Global Equity Income Fund, there's a Best of Asia Fund as well. But the bit I set up in 2010 is the venture capital side of Guinness, and we trade as Guinness Ventures, and this includes the Guinness EIS, Guinness VCT, we have an AIM EIS as well, and our Sustainable Estate Planning Service. And across Guinness, we have 7 billion under management and just over 70 employees.
And your own experience?
For me, I started out in the 1990s in HSBC investment banking, working in the telecoms and technology sector. And that was where I developed a love of growth companies.
So Shane, what does the fund aim to do for investors?
The Guinness EIS aims to give investors a diversified portfolio of at least 10 investee companies across a range of sectors. We also close 4 tranches a year. So one of the things we aim to do is ensure those funds are invested into investee companies within the tax year. And that ensures a timely deployment of money and receipt of EIS certificates for investors.
And what do you look for in an investee company?
So we look at, I think one of the important things we look at is stage of growth. Mm. And mentioned scale up or Series A companies, these are businesses that have already proved up their product or service or technology and are looking to roll that out to a broader market. So one of the ways we filter is we look at businesses that have at least £1 million of historic year turnover. And in fact, last year, of the investments we made, average turnover was more than £5 million. And so these are fairly well-established businesses. I think when looking at businesses, we do due diligence on a range of areas. One key point is, of course, the management team. And I think a credible management team that have a viable business plan is the starting point. Then looking at that management team and suppose whether they have the requisite skills to actually deliver on that business plan. Their self-awareness as well, can they? Are they aware of their limitations? Do they know what they need to bring on board to succeed? Other things we look at in investee companies are growth rates, margins, product market fit, amongst others. Yeah.
Is there any particular sector that you focus on or lean towards, or are you a true generalist investor?
We are generalist investors, and we've invested, our EIS funds are invested across more than 10 sectors. Yeah. That said, within the team, there are specialisms, and we have quite a few investments in healthcare, in education, in consumer-focused businesses. Yes, so those are perhaps some of the specialisms within the team, but broadly we are generalists.
And you mentioned management teams earlier. What particular traits do you look for within a management team? And is there a particular background to the founders that you back?
It's really important not to pigeonhole management teams. Mm. And we take them as they come, building a rapport with those teams, getting under the bonnet of their business plan, and ensuring they have a credible vision. I think some management teams don't understand the size of the task ahead of them, and that's something which is a bit of a warning sign. A key point for us is building an honest and open relationship with management teams. I think we can't trust a management team, there's no possibility of an investment.
So how do you source these investments? Where do you find them?
Well, we have quite an experienced team at Guinness and with the broad network. A lot of investments come to us directly. We're well known in the market, but also through contacts. So we get introduced to a lot of investments through the various trade bodies we're members of, through seminars, through third parties such as lawyers and accountants, family officers, existing investors, brokers. There's quite a lot of sources. And we, as a team, we see hundreds of business plans each quarter. And that's what we love doing. We love looking at business plans. We screen those. We talk to the teams. And even though we may only make a small number of investments each year, and we made 14 investments last year, we'll nevertheless keep in touch with a larger number. And some of those may become investments in the future.
So of those 14 companies, typically how much are you investing in each new business, and what's the typical overall round size?
Our average investment was £3 million. And that might be larger because we go in at the Series A round. It's larger than, say, early stage investments might be. The round size depends. Sometimes we are the round, so it's it might be a £3 or £4 million round, but sometimes it's a syndicate and it could be 10 or 12 million. So it varies from deal to deal, but that's typically the structure.
And do you have any examples of recent investments you've made?
Certainly. So one recent investment we've made is Dragonfly AI, which is a really interesting company. It uses artificial intelligence to optimize products, advertisements, websites for their clients. And their clients include some real household names. There's Unilever and Coca-Cola. Green King's a client as well. Another recent investment we made is a business called PlotBox. And they provide a software management suite to their clients, who are cemeteries. And it's a really unusual niche that they address. But they're a potential world leader in this area. And they have clients across the UK and Ireland, across North America, in Asia, in Australia. And they have grown substantially. So we've invested in this business to help them develop their offering still further, including with flower deliveries.
And what about some of the more established holdings within the wider EIS portfolio? Are there any particular highlights from the portfolio?
Yes, indeed. So Gravity UK is one of our investments, and we invested in Gravity. They had 4 trampoline parks. They now have 17. They've opened some big box leisure sites, one in Wandsworth and most recently in Liverpool. And this has been trading ahead of budget in its first couple of months. It's a 100,000 square foot site. They've got electric go-karting, they've got darts and golf, they've got 6 food outlets and 3 bars in the area. Gravity has been a huge success story. It now employs over 600 people.
So this is the business that takes over predominantly old retail space and creates an experience.
Exactly. So in Wandsworth, they took over the old Debenham site and put in go-kart and bowling and other things. And footfall post-pandemic was 25% ahead of pre-pandemic due to Gravity's presence. So it's a really interesting model, bringing people back into retail centres.
So there could be life on the high street.
Absolutely, yes. Watch this space. And another portfolio company that to mention is Cera Care.
Yeah.
And Cera Care, when we invested, turned over about £4 million, and it's now turning over more than £200 million. It's grown to have 10,000 employees and provides over 40,000 visits to patients in their homes every day. So it's been a phenomenal growth story. And along with that, it's been really improving the lives of patients. The app and data analytics have reduced hospitalizations for those patients by more than 50%, which is astounding. Carers log data for their patients over time, and that data is used in a predictive way to anticipate needs. I think in days of old, a clipboard might be left in a house. Things weren't logged, things weren't picked up. either centrally or by family members. And what Cera Care has transformed that that whole process.
So when you back these businesses, what else are you doing to add value to these companies other than just providing the funding?
We usually sit on the boards or act as observers within investee companies. And we look to help them deliver on their growth business plan. So that might involve helping set strategy. It might be with recruitment or sales and marketing, finance or research and development, and bringing personnel into those areas. And it's not that we're experts in all these areas, but because we've got investments in 50 companies, we have a really strong network of a team of people who can help and whose expertise we can draw on. So that's been a really powerful assistance for our portfolio companies.
And so changing topics slightly and turning to exits, have you had any exits recently? Any particular highlights you can talk
about?
Yes,
well, our most recent one a couple of months ago was Imagen. And Imagen was a media business that's been bought by Thomson Reuters. We held it for just over 4 years and delivered a 2x return to our investors. And it's the latest of a string of investments we've made where there's been buyouts by high-profile businesses. You may recall Content Cal, one of our investee companies, was bought by Adobe. And we also, Pasta Evangelist was bought by Barilla, the world's biggest pasta maker. And Jones Foods by Ocado. So we've had a few sales to high-profile businesses.
And of course, positive exits are great, but there are risks investing at such an early stage. How would you quantify the risk to investors? If every 10 companies you invest in, typically how many would you expect to fail?
I think typically investing in venture capital, you should expect 2 or 3 companies out of 10 to fail. Now, it varies a lot on depending on what point in a company's journey you're investing. There's a lot more failures between seed investment and Series A. Within our portfolio, we've had 5 out of 50 investments. That's actually 1 in 10. I think setting investors' expectations on failures within a portfolio is important. It's a part of the journey.
So finally, to sum up, Shane, for those who want to invest in an EIS fund this year, why should they invest with Guinness Ventures?
Well, I think at Guinness, we've got a really experienced team with a strong network and a passion for investing in some of the best UK companies. We also have a strong track record, as I pointed to, in backing winners. And we actually had 5 in the most recent FTSE fastest growing company mm-hmm. survey. And finally, we put our investors at the heart of everything we do. And I think that's why they thank us by coming back year after year.
Shane Gallwey of Guinness Ventures, thank you very much.
Thank you.
If you are watching on YouTube, please press like and subscribe to the channel for more.